In this video, you'll learn how to create rotating platforms that orbit around a central point. This can be used as a visually appealing component in your game, but also has practical uses. It ensures that there's always a platform nearby for the player to jump onto, and they don't have to wait for one particular platform to make its rounds before returning. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor. Learn practical dev skills and improve the quality of your games by subscribing and ding-a-linging that bell. If you follow this channel, then you've probably seen me dabble in trigonometry from time to time. Nowadays, you don't really need to know a lot of trigonometry as a developer, but it can still be useful to accomplish a few tasks. We'll be using it to manage the platforms that orbit around our controller. We're also going to briefly look at what tool scripts are and how we can create them, which allows you to see what this mechanic looks like in the scene editor. Let's go ahead and get started. The general idea for this platform controller is that we want to have a node that we can move around where we want. We want to be able to add a bunch of platforms to this node, and these platforms will automatically get set up and start orbiting around the controller. So I already have a platform scene set up that I will be using. It will be a moving platform that will move the player and enemies with it, so it is a kinematic body 2D with sync to physics enabled. I also have one-way collision enabled for the shape so that the player can jump up through the platform. Everything we'll be adding to our orbit controller doesn't have to be a platform. We may want to add a small stationary block that the player can jump onto, or some other fancy contraptions. So we're going to need a way to determine which children should orbit the node. There are countless ways of doing this. I will be using groups. So I have added my platform to a group called platforms. Any child within this group will be made to orbit around our controller. As for the controller itself, I just have a Node 2D with a script. Technically, you don't need a special scene for this. You can just pop this onto any Node 2D, but for simplicity's sake, I'm going to have a designated scene for it. Since we're assuming that not every child of this node is going to orbit the node, we want to keep a reference to all the nodes that do, so we can easily tell how many we have and update their positions. We're going to store these platforms in an array named platforms. To seek out these platforms, we're going to create a method named findPlatforms, which we will use to populate our array. This can be called whenever we add or remove platforms to our controller. So we're going to clear out our array and start over by setting the platforms to an empty array. The platforms still exist and are none the wiser to what just happened, we're just clearing out the references. After this, we're going to iterate through all of the children of our controller, interrogating them as to what groups they've been hanging out with lately. So we'll say for child and get children to do the iterating. Then we'll create an if condition saying if child.isInGroup platforms. Again, this is my method for checking. This is where you would put your preferred method. If they are in this group, then we're going to add them to our array by saying platforms.append child. Now that we've spotted our platforms, it's time for us to position them where we want them to be and get them moving. We're going to do this every physics frame, so we'll create our physics process method. I said earlier that we're going to be using a bit of trigonometry to handle our platforms. Specifically, what we're going to be doing is storing the angle as a variable and incrementing it every physics frame. Essentially, we're going to have one point that rotates around our controller, and we're going to use this to place our platforms. We're going to store this point as an angle, so we'll create a class property named orbitAngleOffset, which I will set as 0. This will be a radian between the values of negative pi and pi. We also want to set how fast the platforms orbit around our controller, which will be the time it takes for one platform to complete a one full rotation. We'll store this as an export variable named rotationDuration, ignoring the fact that it sounds like a terrible band name, and defaulting it to 4.0 seconds. With this, we're going to increment our angle, which we'll do by saying orbitAngleOffset plus equals 2 times pi, which is the radian value for a full circle. We'll then multiply this by delta so that it increments by full circle every second, and finally we'll divide our rotation duration so that we can extend this orbit to our specified number of seconds. If we were to let this run, then our orbit angle offset is going to continue to increase, which I mean, it's probably fine. But to be just a little nitpicky and to keep our variables nice and clean, we're going to wrap it around negative pi and pi. Now that we have this lovely little variable, we're ready to use it to update our platforms, which we're going to create a method for and name it just that. We'll be calling this method at the end of our physics process method. As stated, orbit angle offset is just the angle for one point around our orbit controller, but it's entirely possible that we're going to be using several platforms. To place the other platforms, we're going to be spreading them out evenly around the orbit controller based on how many platforms we have. So let's find out what angle we should use for spreading these out. We can do this simply enough by taking 2 times pi, again a full circle, and dividing it by the size of our platform's array, casting it as a float to prevent rounding errors. We're going to store this in a variable named spacing. I don't want to be personally responsible for creating any black holes, so I'll be adding a condition before this that will only run this code if my platforms.size is not equal to 0. Now that we have the spacing between our platforms, we're going to start placing them. We'll iterate through all of our platforms by creating a for loop for I in platforms.size. We'll be setting the position of our platforms, but because it has sync to physics enabled, we can't update one axis at a time. We have to update the whole vector too. So we're going to create a variable named newPosition and initialize it as an empty vector too. We'll set the platform's position to this afterwards. If we plug an angle into cosine and sine and store them as x and y values respectively, we will have created a unit vector, meaning a vector whose values add up to a sum of 1. If we were to plot out random unit vectors, then you would probably start to notice a familiar pattern. And if we were to increment the angle that we use to pass into cosine and sine, then by golly we might just end up with a circle. You can probably see where I'm going with this. So if we say newPosition.x equals the cosine of orbit angle offset, and do the same for the y-axis, except using sine instead, then the platform doesn't move. Wait, I think I see something. Zoom and enhance. Further. Even further. Ah, right. A unit vector has a combined value of 1, meaning that the platforms are orbiting at a radius of 1 pixel around the controller. But if we were to multiply this by a radius of our choosing, we could extend the platforms out even further. We'll create an export variable named radius. This is going to be a vector 2 because ovals are a thing. And I'll default my values to 256 pixels. We can then multiply our cosine and sine values by each respective axis of our radius. Now you may notice that the platforms are all grouped up together. This is because we haven't implemented our separation yet. We did separation as an angle as well, so all we have to do is add it to our cosine and sine functions. We want to increase the spacing for each of our platforms, so we're going to multiply spacing by our iteration. Then just remember to set this position of our platforms by saying platforms i.position equal new position. The controller is nearly functional. If you want to test that it works, then run the find platforms method in your ready method. Once you've ensured that it works, however, delete it if you want. We're going to expand this in such a way that it will be redundant. Seeing the controller in action requires that you run the game in order to see how it looks. We would like to see what it looks like when building our levels. So we're going to turn this into a tool script. We can do this simply enough by adding a word tool at the top of our script. But tool scripts are a bit odd in that they don't update how you might want them to. If you were to add your platforms, it wouldn't work. You would need to close out your scene and reopen it, because the ready method I had you delete will only run once. So we want to call this method whenever we add anything new to the controller. To my knowledge, Godot doesn't have a clean way to detect when we add a child, so instead we're going to keep track of how many children we have. And should this value change, then we'll reset our platform references. Create a variable named previousChildCount and set it to 0. Then, inside of our physics process, we're going to check if previousChildCount does not equal getChildCount. If it doesn't, then we're going to set previousChildCount to getChildCount to prevent this condition from triggering again, and then we'll make a call to find positions. If you want to learn more practical dev skills, then watch this video on how to create falling platforms. And if you're new, then join the sub club to get notified for future videos.